This is a song we don't really ever sing in church, but when I think of heaven and I think of questions about heaven, this is always the first song that pops into my mind. It's a song written by a father who lost his son. His son was 4 years old, and he lost his son, and he wrote this song contemplating, what's it going to be like when I see my son again? The interesting thing about this song is it's not a, is there a heaven? It's, what's it going to be like when I get there? And this is just, for my money, one of the most powerful songs you could sing about heaven. So if you know it, I invite you to sing along with me. Would you know my name if I saw you in heaven? Would it be the same if I saw you in heaven? I must be strong and carry on, 'cause I know I don't belong here in heaven. Would you hold my hand if I saw you in heaven? Would you help me stand if I saw you in heaven? 'Cause I'll find my way through night and day, 'cause I know I just can't stay here in heaven. Time can bring you down, time can bend your knees, time can break your heart, have you beg and plead, beg and beyond the door, there's peace, I'm sure, 'cause I know there'll be no more tears in heaven. Would you know name if I saw you in heaven? Would it be the same if I saw you in heaven? Beyond the door, there's peace, we're sure, 'cause we know there'll be no more tears in heaven. 'Cause we know there'll be no more tears in heaven. Pray with me. God, we thank you for the assurance of heaven. We thank you for sending your son Jesus. God, we know that we have this blessed assurance of life everlasting with you, and we thank you for that. Even in the midst of our uneasiness with what heaven will be like, God, we know that it's going to be awesome. That's one thing we know for sure, and we thank you for that, Lord. It's in Jesus' name that we pray to you this morning. Amen. Amen.
And behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the springs of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Revelation 21. So, did Eric Clapton get it right? Sounds like it. No more tears in heaven. Welcome, everybody, to St. Mark's. I'm Pastor Paul. Everybody online, we're so glad that you're here. We're continuing a series called Since You Asked, and today we're talking about heaven. A lot of people submitted questions about heaven. We asked our congregation to ask any question that they'd like, and a lot of the questions were about heaven. What's it going to be like? How do I know if I'm going to get there? Things like this. And so today we're talking about heaven. And whenever I read from Revelation 21, I always feel like I need to preach a hellfire and brimstone message, you know? Like if you ever go to a church and they're like, "Yeah, we're going through a one-year series on Revelation." Whew, you know what you're going to get like in preaching there every week. You're not going to get that from me, because the reality is this. We don't know a whole lot about heaven, actually. The Bible doesn't tell us every little detail about heaven, and which is kind of interesting, because then everybody develops their own idea of heaven. Check out this image here. This is somebody's idea of heaven. How many of you think there are going to be clouds in heaven? Anybody? See, now, if I didn't show you that image, you might have thought, clouds, that's ridiculous. I like sunlight, you know? I like a sunny summer day, things like that. But I would say a lot of us maybe see heaven like this, and there's always stairway to heaven. Sorry, I can't help myself. How about this picture right here? This is somebody else's picture of heaven. The caption on this one says, "I literally went to heaven and took this picture." Dude, that is a digital picture, and that is the scariest heaven I've ever seen in my life, okay? There are no bats in heaven, or crows, or whatever they are. That is not the mansion I want to stay in. Of course, here's another picture of heaven. There's definitely going to be ice cream in heaven, especially on these hot summer days. You know, we really don't know a whole lot about heaven. The Bible doesn't answer all of our questions about heaven, and so we're left with some common, unanswerable questions about heaven. Let me just give you a few of these that people ask. First one's this: how old will I be in heaven? How old do you want to be in heaven? I'd like to be, I think, 18 years old. Now, I was kind of more of like a skinny weed as an 18-year-old, but I could jump out of the gym when I was 18 years, well, comparatively to my inability to jump. Back then, I could jump a little bit more, and I think I'm gonna be 18. Whisper to the person next to you how old you're gonna be in heaven, or how old you'd like to be in heaven. Go ahead, tell them. 21, 25, 30. Did anybody say, I'd like to be 95? Are there any 95-year-olds here? Just checking. Did anybody say they want to be 5? You see, this is what's so strange. We don't know. Eric Clapton wrote a song about his 4-year-old son dying. Is he going to be 4 when he meets him in heaven? We just don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us. Or how about this question? Where do you go immediately after you die? I mean, is it immediately to heaven? Because some people talk about seeing their body, and they're like, whoa, there goes my body, and I don't know if I'm going to heaven. And then, you know, some people talk about other places that they go, and where do you go immediately after you die? Is heaven like right now, or do we have to wait till Jesus comes again? By the way, there are tons of jokes about heaven. Do you know that? I can't help myself. Two old men, Abe and Saul, they were sitting on a park bench feeding pigeons and talking about baseball. Abe turns to Saul and he asks, do you think there's baseball in heaven? Saul thinks for a minute and replies, I don't know, but let's make a deal. If I die first, I'll come back and tell you if there's baseball in heaven, and if you die first, you do the same. They shake on it, and sadly, a few months later, poor Abe passes on. Soon afterwards, Saul is sitting in the park feeding the pigeons by himself, and he hears a voice whisper, Saul, Saul. Saul responds, Abe, is that you? Yes, it is, Saul, whispers Abe's ghost. Saul, still amazed, asks, so is there baseball in heaven? Well, said Abe, I've got good news and I've got bad news. Well, give me the good news first, says Saul. Abe says, well, there is baseball in heaven. Saul says, that's great. What news could be bad enough to ruin that? Abe sighs and whispers, you're pitching on Friday. That's a good one. Where do you go immediately after you die? Another question people ask is, do you have special abilities, right? You know, I remember Jesus, after his resurrection, you know, he appears to his disciples, and they're in a locked room. John tells us the room is locked. So he has some kind of special abilities, like to get through walls or whatever. It's kind of like that. It's kind of like, will we be like Superman? I'd like to be able to jump like Michael Jordan, you know? Do we have special abilities? Will we be able to cook the finest food if you're not a cook? Do you get to cook really well in heaven? How does that work? Or will we just be like our normal selves? I mean, I think all of us want to have some kind of, you know, extra ability. How about this one? Very common question. Well, I know my friend's relative spouse, how I know them now, right? Ellie and I joke a lot. Well, I actually joke with Ellie about being her husband in heaven. She loves me so much that she tells me that we're going to be married forever. She says it just like that. I'm going to be married to you forever, and don't you forget it, for eternity. And I say, well, babe, you know, Jesus says that there's neither going to be marriage nor be given in marriage in heaven. And she says, well, forget about Jesus. I'm going to be married to you. She doesn't really say that. I'm just kidding. But she does say we're going to be married forever. Are we? I don't know. I don't know. And if you've been married multiple times, who are you going to be married to? That'll be a tough question in heaven, right? But it says, you know, it's going to be all different. Instead, we're going to be the children of God. That's how we're going to relate to each other. Strange. We don't know. Here's a question for you. Will we sleep? I like sleep right now. I can personally tell you that. I could use some good sleep. Will we sleep or will we party every day? Party every day. That was too much for you guys, I could tell. You're like, no, Pastor Paul, don't go there. And then, of course, the question that gets asked in my household is, will we use the restroom? I'm not going to answer that question for you. It's unanswerable. Actually, we asked a bunch of our VBS kids this week what heaven is going to be like. Check out this video.
Happy place. I think heaven's like maybe like Like, I know you lose all, like, if you have any arrows, like, out of the skull or that, it's like you're all healed and everything.
God plays with you.
God. It's, like, clean and, like, there's a lot of things in it. Very happy or, like, very joyful or, like, nothing's wrong.
Peaceful and calm.
Probably has a bunch of water slides, a bunch of donuts, and you don't have to be healthy.
Perfect.
Crazy.
Crazy.
Crazy people.
Not fun, because you're going to be dead there. Like,
I've kind of imagined heaven as a city with a whole bunch of people and kind of a kingdom.
Pearl gates and golden streets.
It's going to be full clouds.
It's probably like a place that has lots of trees and waterfalls, and it looks really nice.
Kids are the best, aren't they? I love it. They're so honest. Like, not fun, because you're going to be dead. Yes! I love it. That is so good. Waterfalls and donuts, you don't have to be healthy. All those are great. Those are great. You know, here's the thing. Even though we don't know everything about heaven, there are some things, there are some cultural perceptions of heaven that are misconceptions. And so I want to go through a few of those, because I think these are pretty important. First one's this. A lot of people believe that we're just going to be spirits in heaven, that we're just going to float around. If you've seen the recent Disney movie Soul, Soul's a great example of this. You know, you get separated from your body and you just have a soul and you float around. Or if you're a Marvel fan, Doctor Strange kind of deals with this a little bit. You know, he's separated. And of course, there's that classic movie, Ghost. Now, I have to tell you something. We had a youth group here from Hutchinson, Minnesota this morning. They went to the first service, and I asked them, how many of you have seen the movie Ghost? Not a single hand went up. How many people have seen the movie Ghost here? How many people under the age of 18 have seen the movie Ghost? That's what I thought. I'm going to mark that one off. Don't use that example anymore. Okay. You know, we have this idea that our soul separates from our bodies, but that's not what Scripture says. It's very fascinating because the Bible is very specific. Christianity is not an Eastern religion. You see, most Eastern religions say that the world and everything in it is corrupt and it's broken and it's dying and it doesn't mean anything. But Christianity says, no, the world means something. Our bodies have meaning, they have purpose. And Paul puts it like this to the Corinthians. He says, and just as we've borne the image of the earthly man, so we will bear the image of the heavenly man. Who's the heavenly man? Sunday school answer. Jesus. He's the heavenly man. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality. What does Jesus do when he comes back to life? He hangs out with the disciples and he eats food with them. That's the next question about heaven. Will we eat food? And if we're going to eat food, do we need to use a restroom? See, I get back to that question. It's very important. Jesus ate food with his disciples. That's what we see all the time. He told Thomas, check me out. I've got my scars. I'm a real human being. I'm not just some floaty spirit someplace. Why is this important? Because we live in a world and a society that looks at the physical as unimportant. That's why we abuse our bodies. That's why we're workaholics and we have heart attacks at age 50 and we say, well, that's just how it is. That's why sex is just a casual thing now and not something that's spiritual. This is why, as Christians, we should actually care about the world and our environment, because the world is a place that we've been commanded to take care of. You see, these things matter. Because we're not just this spirit that floats away and leaves all the trash behind, and finally, we can just be with Jesus. No, that body that you're in right now, that's where the Spirit of the living God dwells. We're told in Scripture that your body is the temple of the Lord. And so it makes a difference, because Jesus came back in flesh. And so we're not just going to be spirits, and thank God. Who wants to be a floating spirit anyway? Boo. Boo. You know? I could tell you, when I was a kid, one of the things I just dreaded about heaven was the choir. I love singing, but when I was in seventh grade, I was 6'5". Yes, you can say it. Freak of nature, okay? And I was in the choir, and in my church, St. Paul Lutheran Church, we were celebrating our 100th anniversary. And so forever in the annals of St. Paul Lutheran Church, we have the school choir there. And there's all the kids. And then there's the Tower of Babylon in the middle with me. You know, my robe was like here to my knees. I said, God, please don't put me in the choir when I get to heaven. We're not going to just be spirits. We're going to be flesh and blood as well. Another misconception about heaven, that we're going to miss everyone on earth. You know, that we got to come back and bug people here on earth. Let me tell you what Isaiah's experience of heaven was like. Isaiah chapter 6, it says this, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. This is not an image of something that's boring. This is going to take all of your imagination. It's going to captivate you. And you're not going to be concerned about the earth. You're not going to be concerned about the people on the earth. And I know we live kind of in a time where we don't want to really believe that. We want to think that grandma's looking down at us and things like that. Grandma doesn't care about you. I'm going to tell you that right now, because she's in the presence of Jesus. That is really, really good news. Because there's no more tears, she's not hurting anymore, right? I mean, we've got this idea that we want to be connected in some way, but the fact of the matter is we're not going to miss everyone on earth. Let me give you just this analogy. Have you ever flown on an airplane and you bought yourself a coach ticket and you're crammed in with everybody in the back, right? People are literally breathing all of their air particles right onto the back of your neck. It's disgusting, right? That's the way I fly, and I think most people do. But then you get to the gate and they say, "Excuse me, sir, you know, we're too full in the coach. Could we bump you up to first class?" Yeah. And you sit in first class. How many of you are concerned about the people in coach? Not a single one of us. We're like, "I'll take some more of that, please. You know, let me have my warm hand cloth." If that is what it's like on an airplane, imagine the magnitude of what heaven's going to be like, right? You're just not going to miss the earth. You're going to be in heaven. Finally, the final misconception is that everyone that's good goes to heaven. This is the biggest misconception in our world. And I have a confession to make to you. I don't know if this makes me a bad pastor, but I've never read a single book or watched a single movie about heaven. No, I have not watched The Shack. Sorry, I haven't watched 90 Minutes in Heaven or Heaven is for Real or Proof of Heaven or The Five People You Meet in Heaven, but I hear they're great books, and I'm sure they're wonderful. They're all New York Times bestsellers. This is how interested people are in heaven. They want to know. But I haven't read them all, and here's the general feeling I get about all of them. The general feeling I get about all of them is that when you go to heaven, you really just kind of meet good people, the people that are supposed to be there. You know, not Osama bin Laden. Not that really bad neighbor down the road, because they're not good enough. This is the biggest misconception we have about heaven. Because you don't get to heaven by how good you are. You get to heaven by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how you get to heaven, by believing in him. Now, I know that's unfair, because that's what you think in your mind. You think to yourself, that's unfair, because good people should get good rewards. But here's the trick. None of us are good when you compare us to the law of God. And you read that throughout Scripture. Everywhere in Scripture it says, we can't keep up with the law of God. And so we got to rely on something else. We've got to rely on Jesus. That's where most people take a misstep when it comes to heaven. Because they think, this person is really good over here. They deserve heaven. The only person who deserves heaven is Jesus, and he gives it to you through faith. To kind of highlight this, I've got another joke for you. This is a good one. A cab driver reaches the pearly gates. Let's just update it to today. An Uber driver reaches the pearly gates. St. Peter looks him up in his big book and tells him to pick up a gold staff and a silk robe and proceed into heaven. Next in line is a pastor. This is guaranteed. St. Peter looks him up in his big book, furrows his brow and says, "Okay, we'll let you in, pastor, but take that cloth robe and wooden staff over there." The pastor's shocked and replies, "But I'm a man of the cloth. You gave that cab driver a gold staff and a silk robe. Surely I rate higher than a cabbie." St. Peter responds matter-of-factly, "This is heaven, and up here we are interested in results. When you preached, people slept. When the cabbie drove his taxi, people prayed." Yeah, exactly. You see, we don't know everything about heaven. We certainly have some misconceptions about heaven. If you really want to know about heaven, you need to look into Scripture. Because Scripture is not confusing about heaven. Every time Scripture talks about heaven, it tells us a few things. First one is this. The Bible tells us about heaven to encourage us in this life. The Bible doesn't tell us about heaven to make us fearful if we're going to make it or not. It's simply there to encourage us. Jesus says, "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I've overcome the world." You see, God understands that this world is difficult. That's why he has set up a new heaven and a new earth where there's going to be peace, where there's going to be joy. He gets that. And so every time you read about heaven in the Bible, it's an encouragement to you. Jesus says, I'm going to come back. It's an encouragement to face the junk of this life and to know that there is a better life waiting for you. The Bible tells us about heaven to assure us of God's promises. The writer of Hebrews in chapter 10, I love this chapter because it talks about being bold enough to approach the high place, the temple of God. And so you see this kind of vision of heaven, and he says to us, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, not because we're so good or not because we are so faithful, but because he who promised is faithful." Every time we hear about heaven, God is saying, "This is my guarantee for you. I've got a place for you." The Bible tells us about heaven to point us to what's to come, to remind us that there's a great place. Jesus says, "In my Father's house, there are many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back again, and you've got a place." Do you realize you have a place with your name on it? Now, in our society, that probably doesn't resonate with us because most of us have homes or apartments to live into. We pay good money for those things. But think about the rest of our world where people don't have their own place. What joy it is to know that God has written on a doorpost someplace in heaven, Paul Hennings. Every time you hear about heaven in the Bible, it's to point us to what's to come. And finally, the Bible tells us about heaven to remind us of Jesus' first coming and his soon-to-be second coming. Because see, heaven is open for you because Jesus came down from heaven and he lived a righteous life. And then we crucified him because we didn't understand him. But in his death, he defeated death. And when he rose again, that was the guarantee of heaven for us. And so every time you read in Scripture about heaven, it always points you back to Jesus, 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 because he's the guarantee. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will never end. You know, the great thing about the Bible is that it doesn't give us all the details about heaven. Isn't that great? So we get to use our imagination. We get to wonder, what is it going to be like? What's my room going to be like? What's it going to be like to be with my two boys in heaven someday? What age do I get to be when I get to heaven? Are there going to be waterfalls and water slides and donuts? Do I get to eat whatever I want, all the cholesterol that I could possibly handle, and just live forever? I want you guys to close your eyes with me just for a second. Just close your eyes, and right now I want you to imagine heaven. Whatever you're imagining, all the things, all the people that are there, keep on imagining that. Now I want you to add one thing, actually one person, to your image. I want you to add Jesus. Jesus looking at you with arms outstretched. And then I want you to hear his voice. He's saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and receive the reward I have for you." And his smile is big. And he's embracing you. And he's calling you by name. And he says, "You are mine." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to be with you someday. And so we put our hope and our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. He is the guarantor. He's the perfecter of our faith. And we can't wait to see you in heaven. Thank you for giving us your Son, Jesus Christ. His death and his resurrection promises us a place in heaven. We love you, Jesus, and we pray this in your name. Amen.